So, hi everyone, I am Srijan. I am from Department of Surgical Oncology at Basudharkam Cancer Hospital, Hyderabad. And without further wasting any time, let's start. Disclaimers first, because the topic itself is a little bit dry. It's a very theoretical topic. So, the presentation today would sound like a didactic lecture. I am in no way an expert in this field. I am barely 1 or 2 years seniors to all of you. So this is just more like a revision for me, and hopefully I can help you guys. This topic is also multidisciplinary in its nature, as such that me being a surgical oncologist, I have with me Navneet here, who's a radiation oncologist. I hope there is some medical oncologist also. And apart from that, you need endocrinologist, radiologist, and other guys on your team, because this will test the strength of your team and not you alone per se. Third thing is, for all those who are present online right now, the way I have made this PPT is such that you'll need active attention, because Men's syndrome is a very, very wide syndrome per se. It will have many disorders from the different endocrine order organs. And what happens is, once you think of, say, for example, MEN2, and you are thinking only of medullary thyroid cancer, you forget to think about the other things. Same is with MEN1. It will have 3-4 type of cancers, other smaller, less common type of cancers. So the idea of my presentation today is, at the end of it, at least the 11 of us should have a correct understanding of the width of the syndrome, and not so much as the depth of it, because the depth of it, I know on this forum only, I saw on YouTube that there have been discussions on neuroendocrine tumors, there have been discussion on thyroid cancers and everything. So thinking about a tumor in depth at one time is one thing, but once you have a patient of a Men's syndrome in front of you, and I'll give you examples, you need to have a lateral thought process. So that is how I've outlined this. First, we'll go through the endocrine systems, we'll revise them, what is the basic anatomy and physiology. We'll just brush through the endocrine tumors which are encountered through all these organs. Because once I do that, after discussing Men's syndromes, it will become too much of, you know, a detailed thing, and you'll be bombarded with data. So we'll do that first. And then at the end, we'll go to the Men's syndromes, see how these individual tumors behave differently in men. So what I mean to say is, if you have gastrinoma in a sporadic case versus you have gastrinoma in a Men's syndrome, how will it be different? So we'll see the differences when we go later. We'll talk about gastrinoma first, and then later, when we come to Men's syndrome, we'll see the differences. And at last, we'll see the screening recommendations and treatment. Does that sound okay? Kush and Navneet and others?
Yes, yes, yes.
Yeah. So first to you two, and anyone else also, because we are just hardly 10, 11 people. So anyone can answer. Let's first brush out and throw out, vomit out all the endocrine organs that we know. Anyone can start. Top to bottom. All the endocrine organs in the human body.
Pituitary gland, breast, thyroid, adrenal.
Okay. So breast is an endocrine gland or an exocrine gland?
Sorry, exocrine.
So you have pituitary, you have thyroid. Yeah. Then next, something in the neck, you said thyroid. With thyroid you have?
Parathyroid.
So three, pituitary, thyroid, parathyroid. Let's come down. You said adrenal.
Adrenal.
Then where do hormones come from?
Pancreas, both.
Pancreas. Correct. So pancreas. Any other place hormones come from in the human body? We have reached here. My cursor is visible, right? Yeah. So let's go down in the pelvis. The gonads. Testes in males and ovaries in females. They'll be secreting the hormones. Okay. So this exercise is just because you should first know what are the endocrine glands in your body where the Men's syndrome, which is multiple endocrine neoplasia can occur. Okay. So pineal gland, pituitary, thyroid, parathyroid, thymus, adrenal, pancreas, gonads. Okay. We are good?
Yes.
Yeah. Sure. So pineal gland and gonads, the top and the bottom, don't feature so much commonly in men's syndromes. Okay. What feature commonly in men's syndromes are the ones in between. Pituitary, thyroid, parathyroid, thymus also to a certain extent, adrenal glands and pancreas. These are the main five or six organs that you have to focus on. So anytime someone says men's syndrome, you should first just think about these five to six organs. Okay? So let's go to these organs one by one and see what they are made up of, what do they do. So first is pituitary. Pituitary, as we know, hypothalamus, then below will be pituitary. Hypothalamus will secrete a releasing or a inhibitory hormone. They'll secrete anterior or the posterior part of pituitary or the hypophysis as we call it. And the hormone will be released from pituitary. Pituitary itself will control the other endocrine organs per se. So anterior pituitary, what will be there? You'll have FSH, LH, you will have thyroid stimulating hormones, TSH, prolactin, growth hormone, and adrenocortical hormone, ACTH. What will be there in posterior? Any of you two? What will posterior pituitary secrete?
ADH.
ADH and oxytocin. Correct. So ADH and oxytocin, both will be coming from posterior pituitary hormone. So we know the function of all these, right? Basic, we understand what all these hormones do. So what will be the symptoms of an adenoma or a tumor that is coming from pituitary? Generally, the first will be the biochemical raise in the specific hormone. So you can have a hormone which is either secreting only prolactin. You can have a hormone tumor which is either secreting only ACTH, like that. So due to the biochemical excess, you will have one or the other syndrome. If you have prolactin, it will be amenorrhea, infertility, galactorrhea in women, impotence and infertility in men. If it's growth hormone, it will be acromegaly. If it will be ACTH, it will lead to Cushingoid features. Correct. So that will be one part. Biochemical excess leading to whatever hormone is being secreted more, the syndrome of that. The other will be pressure symptoms due to local increase in size. So the pressure symptoms most commonly will be headache, or and because pituitary is in the cella trisica near the ophthalmic nerves, it will also cause visual field changes. Okay, so back to basics, back to MBBS. Pituitary adenoma, you'll have biochemical excess hormones and pressure symptoms. So how do we evaluate pituitary tumors? You know that someone has pituitary tumor or you're suspecting. You will do a biochemical profile, which will include all these hormones that I told you, or any one or two of them if you have narrowed it down. And with that, you'll obviously do a imaging, which will be MRI brain. With these two, you should be able to diagnose it. There is no other need of doing a transcranial biopsy or endonasal biopsy or anything. If you have the typical syndrome, you have a biochemical raise and you're able to see a pituitary tumor. The treatment generally is medical or surgical. For prolactinomas and the ones which are associated with syndromes, and repeating prolactinoma again and again, because prolactinoma will be the most common pituitary tumor which you see in men one. Okay. So if it's a prolactinoma, you use dopamine agonists. They are bromocriptine, cabergoline, and obviously you won't do it. You will take help of your neurosurgery colleagues. You take help of your endocrinology colleagues. You can also use octreotide, lanreotide, somatotropin agonists for these kind of tumors. There are indications for surgery in pituitary tumors, and they are generally when the medical therapy is not working or suspected invasion is there in the pituitary. In such a case, transsphenoidal surgeries are done either endoscopically or open, and plus minus radiation is given if there is a residual left or there's a positive margin. So this in short is what pituitary tumors are all about. Let's go down. Let's come to the parathyroids, the second in the list. So we know the embryology of parathyroids. We keep repeating it when we talk about them during thyroid classes. So superior and inferior parathyroids, two inferior. The superior one actually comes from the fourth branchial pouch, whereas the inferior parathyroid as well as the thymus, they come from the third branchial pouch. So in embryology, what happens? It's not that the superior goes up. The superior actually stays in between only. It stays in the middle part of the thyroid gland. Because the thymus goes down and is taken down with the other mediastinal structures as it gets separated from the pharyngeal wall, with the thymus, the inferior parathyroids descend. And that is why they become inferior. So that's the embryology of parathyroids. What about the C cells? Parathyroid gland secrete parathormone. What do C cells secrete? Kush?
Calcitonin.
So C cells secrete calcitonin. Parathyroid increases the calcium. Calcitonin decreases the calcium. Ultimobranchial body, which are the neural crest cells, they migrate to the superolateral part of the thyroid gland, where the C cells or the parafollicular C cells are most dominant. So what is the cancer that comes out of C cells? It's the medullary thyroid cancer. So where are medullary thyroid more common? They'll be common in the superolateral part of the thyroid. So that's the anatomy. What about the physiology? Just a quick brush up. Parathormone, what does it do? It does three part, acts at three places on the bone. It will cause osteolysis, and calcium will be released. In the kidney, it will cause calcium reabsorption. It will also cause the conversion of vitamin D to dihydroxyacetriol. And from that, what will that cause? It will cause reabsorption of calcium from the GI tract. So through bone, through kidney, through BGI, it will cause increase in the calcium levels. Whereas calcitonin will do the opposite from the bone and the kidney. So that is the calcium homeostasis. Coming to hyperparathyroidism, which is seen both in men 1, men 2, as well as men 4. In all the men syndromes, you'll see parathyroidism. So what is hyperparathyroidism, or as we call it, HPTH? So see, this is a graph which y-axis is the parathyroid levels. On the x-axis is the calcium levels. Okay, so in a patient in whom the calcium is also low and the parathyroid hormone is also low, parathormone is low, calcium is also low. So what would it be called? It would be called a hypoparathyroidism. That is, parathyroid is working less. In whom it will happen? It will happen after surgical resection. So post-total thyroidectomies that we get hypoparathyroidism, it will fall here. It can also be seen in autoimmune diseases, and let's leave that for today's discussion. If we have more parathormone and more calcium, we'll come here in this part. That becomes your primary hyperparathyroidism. Okay, so primary hyperparathyroidism is when parathormone is being secreted more, and due to that, calcium is being raised. What are the conditions which cause this? It can be caused by hyperplasia, it can be caused by adenomas, and it can be caused by carcinomas, which are seen in Men's syndrome. Men's syndrome will have hyperplasia. Men's syndrome will also have adenomas. Carcinomas, surprisingly, are rare in Men's syndromes. Okay, but what will be unique to Men's syndromes? You will have multiglandular hyperplasias. You will have multiglandular adenomas if there, or you can have one gland which is showing adenoma with the other gland showing hyperplasia. So that will be primary hyperparathyroidism. Let's come to a situation where the calcium is low, and because of that, the parathormone keeps going high. Where is this commonly seen? You just have to visit a renal transplant unit. Any center which has a nephrology unit, you go there, all the patients who are waiting for a kidney transplant with chronic renal disease, they will have chronic hypocalcemia. And because of that chronic hypocalcemia, their PTH hormone keeps going up. And after a point of time, that parathormone becomes becomes independent secretion. So even if now you correct the calcium levels, even if you do the renal transplant, it will still be high. So that's called secondary hyperparathyroidism. Okay. And secondary hyperparathyroidism is not what we are interested in today. We are just interested in primary hyperparathyroidism. Okay. So there is also something called as PTH independent hypercalcemia, and that is when there is a malignancy, hypercalcemia happening and all those things. So this is just a cause of hypercalcemia unrelated to PTH. So primary hyperparathyroidism, as I said, I explained you the cause. So what are the symptoms that you will get? A very common mnemonic: stones, moans, groans, thorns, psychic tones. Stones are where in the body? Anyone?
Kidney.
Yeah, renal stones. What are the moans? Abdominal pain. Okay, due to hypercalcemia. What is the thrones? This thrones is actually, I even forgot or I recently read. So what is thrones? Anyone? So thrones is because of hypercalcemia, patient will have polydipsia and polyuria, and he'll be going again and again to the washroom. So he'll be again and again sitting on the commode. So that is the throne that they are talking about. So that is thrones. And psychic tones is obviously mental disturbances. So how do we evaluate primary hyperparathyroidism, as we'll discuss later in screening? Okay, you have diagnosed a patient or a relative as men 1 or men 2. You want to rule out primary hyperparathyroidism. How would you do it? You will do a biochemical test only. You will do serum calcium. You will do serum PTH. You will do both. And I will tell you why we will do both later. You will do both. And if something is abnormal, you will go ahead with a USG neck. You will go ahead with the system AB scintigraphy scan, which you have to do. Okay. And once you have diagnosed it, what is the treatment? Most of the times, an adenoma will require excision. In men's syndromes, it is said that you go ahead with a subtotal or a total parathyroidectomy, which is at least removal of 3.5 glands. Okay. And if you have removed completely or you're planning to remove completely, you have an option of autotransplantation into the forearm. Transplantation again into the neck, into the sternocleidomastoid, is generally not encouraged in men's syndromes because, you know, you've done a bilateral neck exploration and these patients have higher chances of recurrences. So later it's difficult to go inside that neck again and keep doing neck surgeries again and again. So it will be fibrosed. Patient will require general anesthesia. So you put it in the forearm. It can be removed under some block or some local anesthesia. So that's autotransplantation. In patients who are resistant to all this and recurring again and again, calcimimetics like cinacalcet are also an option. We'll discuss about this surgical treatment in men specifically later. So this is just to give you an overview of how parathyroid tumors in endocrine tumors behave, how will they present, and how will you evaluate, and what are your options for treatment. With parathyroid, we also discussed about the C cells, which is the cells secreting calcitonin, the ones which will give rise to the medullary thyroid cancer. So parathyroid, I told you, they'll present as either biochemical evaluation you'll do and on screening you'll pick something up, or they'll have that one of the stones, groans, thrones wala symptom. What will be there in MTC? Because it also secretes calcitonin. We will obviously do a calcitonin level. But somehow they don't present with hypocalcemia. Okay, they present with solitary neck nodule, or they'll present with neck nodes. Okay, or they'll present with some signs of distant mets. Diarrhea is also one symptom which is common in MTC. How do we evaluate a patient of MTC? You evaluate a patient of MTC like any other patient with a thyroid solitary nodule. You'll do an ultrasound neck, you'll see the thyroids, you'll do the FNAC. On FNAC, you'll come to know. You may come to know that it's medullary thyroid cancer. If you come to know, you will do a serum calcitonin and CEA levels. if the CEA levels are very high, more than 150, you will do a distant metastatic workup, which can include CT, neck, chest, abdomen, or an FDG PET CT if you believe that in your center. Some old examiners will ask you what is the role of liver MRI in an MTC patient, and that is because medullary thyroid cancer patients specifically have subcapsular liver mets. So a liver MRI sometimes catches liver mets when your other tests might not. So that is how we evaluate a medullary thyroid cancer patient. What is the treatment? Generally, it's surgery. It will be
surgery. Hello. Can we do DOTATET in MTC?
Correct, you can.
Okay.
So nuclear imaging will be there, but what happens is MTC generally are a poor differentiating tumors. They are not like your well-differentiated neuroendocrine tumors, the ones you see in pancreas. So even the ones in you see in pancreas, what happens? Well, when they are well-differentiated, you will pick up in your DOTA scan. Once they become poorly differentiated and de-differentiate, you will pick them up in FDG PET CT. So in fact, there are centers and guidelines also which recommend that you do DOTA scan and FDG PET both in neuroendocrine tumors. So let's avoid those, you know, potholes. For neuroendocrine, FDG PET is what is routinely done if you want to do a distant met workup. DOTATET scan, I am not very sure, but I don't think it's recommended over FDG PET CT. The treatment, it's generally for a localized disease, it's surgery, okay, which includes total thyroidectomy with central lymph node dissection plus minus lateral lymph node dissections. Adjuvant RT can be considered in patients in whom the margins are positive or it was a R plus resection to begin with, or there were bulky nodes. It is said that in medullary thyroid cancer, you should not do a very aggressive loss of function surgery, okay. In patients who are unresectable, palliative RT can be considered. For metastatic setting, you have multiple options. You have the option of surveillance in which you see the doubling time of calcitonin. You have TKIs, vandetanib, cabozantinib, the two specific ones for MTC. And there is chemotherapy option, dacarbazine, for patients who cannot afford these. So that's what you think about MTC in one thought process. When you see a patient of MEN2 that we'll discuss later. Let's come down again to pancreas. Pancreas, we discussed both exocrine. The exocrine enzymes are labeled up. Amylase, lipase, protease. The hormones I've written are labeled below in this, which come from the islet cells. Insulin, glucagon, somatostatin, okay, VIP. So with the pancreas, you also talk of the GI hormones. So the one we are interested in is the gastrin, which gets secreted in the duodenum and stomach. Okay, there are also other hormones that come out of the GI tract, which include the CCK and secretin, but they generally don't form tumors in the neuroendocrine tumor that happens inside MEN1. Okay. So when you talk about gastroentero pancreatic neuroendocrine tumors, as they are called now, what do they include? They include this type, which is the non-functioning NET, in which there is no specific hormone which is causing a syndrome. Okay. But there are all these other types also, which have a specific hormone which is being secreted. Gastrinoma, insulinoma, somatostatin, glucagon, VIP, all of them have different symptoms. The evaluation of them is also different biochemically, and the treatment for all of them are different. So I know you've already had a talk on this, so I won't go very deep into it, but let's just stick to the basics here and what to think about each one of them when you think. So when we hear gastrinoma, you have to first remember gastrinoma triangle. What is the gastrinoma triangle? It is the triangle where majority of the gastrinomas form. It is between the cystic duct, the junction of second and third part of duodenum, and the body and neck of pancreas. This includes majority of the duodenum and the head of pancreas. Most of the gastrinomas will occur in duodenum. Some of them will occur in pancreas. When they occur in duodenum, they are generally smaller and they are generally multiple. When they occur in the pancreas, they are generally larger. They have a more chances of spreading to the local lymph nodes and distant mets, which is the liver. Okay. So that is gastrinoma. What are the symptoms? Refractory peptic ulcers. You can have diarrhea, or if they become very large in size, which is less common, or they spread to lymph nodes or liver, you can have symptoms based on that spread. How do we evaluate them? You will do a fasting serum gastrin concentration. With that, what you will do, you will also do a basal gastric acid ka pH. So if you have a raised gastrin with a pH which is less than 2, that becomes a clinical diagnosis of gastrinoma. Okay. If it's not coming clear on this test, you have the option of doing something called as calcium and secretin stimulation test. You have the option of doing a nuclear imaging. That is again your somatostatin scintigraphy. Okay. And that becomes with obviously you that CT and MRI are always an option. CT is preferred. So treatment for gastrinoma, it's not surgery in the first go. Most of the gastrinomas which are in the duodenum, which are generally small, which are generally multiple, it's not recommended that you go inside and do a Whipple's on the first day. If they are small, the symptoms now can be controlled with PPIs. The symptoms can be controlled with somatostatin analogs if PPIs are not working. In some patients, it also will respond to H2 antagonists like ranitidine, cimetidine. So a medical attempt has to be given to them unless you have lymph node mets, unless they are bigger in size, or unless they are in head of pancreas. So these are generally considered the risk factors for spread. If it's in the head of pancreas, if it's larger than 2 centimeters in size, or if the lymph nodes are enlarged, these are the patients you would want to do a surgery upfront. Otherwise, medical management. And if it's obviously spread to distant mets, you discuss them in the tumor board and you decide whether to do a cytoreductive surgery, whether to subject them to TKI, whether to subject them to PRRT or chemo. So all these are options. Let's come to insulinoma. Insulinoma, very characteristic. Firstly, the location. Gastrinoma was gastrinoma triangle. What is insulinoma? Insulinoma is equally divided between your head, your body, and the neck of pancreas. Okay. What are the symptoms? Whipple triad. What is Whipple triad? You will have episodic hypoglycemia. You will have 2 CNS symptoms which are associated with the hypoglycemia, and you will have 3 dramatic reversal of these symptoms when you are given glucose. So hypoglycemia, CNS symptoms of hypoglycemia, and reversal by glucose. This is Whipple triad, which is again the clinical diagnosis of insulinoma. What is the evaluation? You will do blood sugar. You will see, you will do the insulin levels. You will see the ratio. According to the ratio, if it's more than, I think, 0.4 or 0.6, I can't remember right now, it is diagnostic. You can also do C-peptide and pro-insulin levels. And if they are markedly raised, they again confirm your diagnosis. Apart from that, this will, you know, doing this, having a typical symptom and doing this insulin levels, that is just a biochemical diagnosis. But how do you locate them? Locating insulinomas are a problem. So the highest sensitivity these days is with EUS, only superseded by intraoperative USG and palpation. So you do a CT, you try to find, you're not able to find, do an EUS. With EUS also, multiple are seen. You don't know which one is the functioning one. You'll have to open it up, explore the whole pancreas, do an intra-op USG, and then either attempt enucleation or some form of pancreatectomy, which is feasible. That becomes insulinoma. What about the non-functioning NET? It's also a very common type. No syndrome will be associated with it. And because there will be no syndrome associated with it, they are generally larger and they are very commonly metastasized to liver and other distant places. The rate of mets is related to the size of the non-functioning NET. So, for example, if it's more than 4 centimeters in size, more than 40% are mets at diagnosis. If they are 2 to 3 centimeters in size, roughly 20% will be metastatic at presentation. If they are less than 1 centimeter in size, that is when their risk of metastasis at presentation is less than 5%. So, because non-functioning, generally larger, no symptom, and mets common. However, what's happening? What's happening is more and more commonly, they are being incidentally detected. More and more commonly, people are undergoing scans for other things when you are finding these non-functioning NETs. More and more commonly, now we are finding these MEN syndrome patients and keeping them on strict screening and surveillance. And that's why now the incidence of finding metastatic non-functioning NET at presentation is slowly decreasing. So that becomes non-functioning NET. What are the other types? Glioblastoma, VIPoma, in one line, glioblastoma will cause dermatitis, diarrhea, diabetes, 3D. Dermatitis, necrolytic erythema migratum, diarrhea, and diabetes mellitus. What will VIPoma cause? It will cause WDHA syndrome. Or what is WDHA? Anybody? Let me breathe for one moment.
Watery diarrhea, dehydration, hypokalemia. A for.
And A is achloridria. So that is VIPoma, Werner-Mollison syndrome. So glioblastoma and VIPoma both are seen in body and tail. Okay. So see, we are moving from right to left. Gastrinoma is duodenum and head. Insulinoma is all three parts. Glioblastoma, VIPoma is body and tail. Okay. And because they will be in body and tail, they again, if they have symptoms, they might come early. Otherwise, they are most of the times large. And most of the times, they are 40 to 60% time metastatic at presentation. What is the treatment? If it's localized, you go ahead with surgery. If it's metastatic, you discuss in our tumor board and you decide whether you can go ahead with a cytoreductive surgery if the patient is symptomatic. Okay. If the patient is not symptomatic, then all the other systemic treatment options like TKI, PRRT, local ablation of the liver with some surgery, all those options are possible. Okay. Somatostatinoma, one tumor that is rare in MEN syndrome and we will not discuss. So that becomes your GPNET, pancreatic NET, along with gastroentero. So now next is adrenal. So you know how an adrenal looks on a CT scan? Any of you? Can you find here in the both these two scans? This one? Ye dikh raha hai? And this one. So inverted V and Y or T-shaped structure, which are just seen in the suprahilar part, are your adrenals on normal imaging. What are the parts of adrenal gland? You'll have a cortex and you'll have a medulla. In the cortex, you have glomerulosa that secretes the mineral corticoids. You have fasciculata, which secretes the glucocorticoids. And you have reticularis that secretes the adrenal androgens. Okay. The medulla will secrete your catecholamines. Okay, clear up by till now. So this basic flowchart, we need to remember. Tyrosine converts to dopamine. Dopamine converts to norepinephrine. Okay, norepinephrine gets converted to nonmetanephrine. Normetanephrine gets converted to vanillamandelic acid. What converts norepinephrine to nonmetanephrine? COMT. Okay, what converts norepinephrine to epinephrine? PNMT. What is the problem with PNMT? PNMT is present only in the adrenal medulla. Okay. And it requires steroids to potentiate its action. So what is the clinical significance of it? If you have extra adrenal pheochromocytomas, okay, you will not have this enzyme with you. So extra adrenal pheochromocytomas will only secrete norepinephrine, normetanephrine. They will not be able to secrete epinephrine and metanephrine. Okay. So adrenal tumors, generally, if you see adrenal incidentalomas, that is just the incidental adrenal findings that you have a 2 cm lesion in the adrenal, 1 cm lesion in adrenal. What are the chances? 80% of the times there will be adenomas. Okay. 5% times each there will be pheochromocytoma or adrenocortical carcinoma. And 2.5% these all will be uncommon, will be metastasis, hematoma. So Mets is actually less common if you see just adrenal incident loma. So why I have shown this is you have to remember that 80% of times anything that is seen on a PET CT or a CT incidentally will be an adenoma. So it's important to know what an adrenal adenoma looks like on CT. So how do we know? See, this is the same CT that I'm playing. Are you able to see the normal adrenal glands now very clearly? BY shaped? So am I audible?
Yes, sir, it's visible.
Yeah.
Yes, yes.
Yeah. So how do you diagnose these different adrenal lesions? You go with the attenuation factor on plain CT. Okay. You know the Hounsfield's unit, correct? So an adenoma is generally will have a high intracellular lipid. Okay. So that comes out to less than 10. If you know how fat looks on CT, it looks dark, correct? So if you have less than 10 Hounsfield's unit, 10 HU on a plain CT all around that adrenal lesion, 98% of the times it will be an adenoma. Okay. Are there exceptions? Yes. 30% times of adenomas, they will have more than 10, and few phoebromocytomas can also have cystic changes and hemorrhage and come less than 10. But you know, 98% of the times you have less than 10 HU, it will be an adrenal adenoma. Okay. So, but attenuation cannot be only thing. As we have seen, phoebromocytoma and these atypical adenomas are also there. So what to do? You have to do a adrenal protocol. You all will know what is a pancreatic protocol, stomach protocol, and rectum protocol. What's the adrenal protocol? You'll do an plain CT. You'll do a dynamic contrast enhanced scan and a 15-minute cut delayed enhanced scan. Okay. And you will take 2 mm cuts in the adrenal region. With that, you calculate these two washouts, an absolute washout and a relative washout. Absolute washout is the enhanced one minus delayed and enhanced minus unenhanced ratio. And relative is enhanced minus delayed upon enhanced into 100. So this is your absolute washout and relative washout. And when you have more than 60% washout on absolute and relative more than 40% washout, this is a diagnostic of an adenoma. So you have less than 10 HU, more than 10 HU, you do a washout study and you have these findings that will diagnose your adenoma. So adrenal lesions, this is the imaging protocol that you need to do when you are diagnosing and evaluating adrenal lesions. What about the biochemical workup? I told you there are all these hormones and things coming out of adrenal. What to do? So generally, biochemical workup ideally is to be done in all adrenal incident lomas. And which tests have to be done? For cortisol testing, you have to do a low dose dexamethasone separation test, or you do a urinary free cortisol. You have to do either a plasma free metanephrine or a urinary free metanephrine in all. And you have to do a angiotensin-renin ratio in all adrenal syndroma who have hypotension or hypokalemia. So metanephrine in all, cortisol testing in all, and angiotensin-renin ratio only if they have hypertension and or hypokalemia. So pheochromocytoma is what we are interested in all these. Adenomas, obviously, you don't do anything unless they are more than 4 centimeters in size. So how do you prepare pheochromocytomas? This is a little bit becoming a surgical question. So may not be of value to everyone else, but you should know that when you have pheochromocytomas, you'll come with, what is the classic triad? It's sweating, palpitation, and hypertension. Hypertension is in the range of 180, 200, 260. Okay, by 140, 160, your diastolic pressure is 140, 160. So how do you prepare them for surgery? You give them a alpha blockade. Previously, it used to be non-selective, which is phenoxybenzamine. Nowadays, you do selective, that is prazosin. You have to counsel for side effects, especially postural hypertension when you are starting these. And you have to counsel them that they have to take fluid and salt intake to increase their intravascular volume expansion. Because what happens is once you give alpha blockers, suddenly there is postural hypertension, your volume loss happens inside the lumen. So you want to increase their volume expansion. So even though they are hypertensive at present, you counsel them to encourage them to take more fluids and more salt so that they don't go into these hypertension episodes. It should never be beta blockers alone. It should never be beta blockers first. Okay. I hope that is very, very clear. And they can be added later after 2 to 3 days of alpha blockers if they are having a lot of tachycardia because of this alpha blocker. Okay. So generally a 7 to 10 days preparation. So when do you treat pheochromocytomas or other adrenal lesions? When they are symptomatic, mostly pheochromocytomas are generally symptomatic when they are more than 4 centimeters in size, when they have atypical or suspicious radiological features, when they are in between 1 to 4 centimeters in size, or you are keeping them in follow-up and there is a measurable growth over a 6-month period. Okay, so these are your indications for surgery in your adrenal lesions. What is the surgery? Generally, adrenal resection will be there, unilateral or bilateral. If it's bilateral, you try to do a partial adrenalectomy. So with this, I think I'll just talk for 30 seconds here and just give you a half a minute to recollect what we have discussed so far. We discussed pituitary, anteriorly, posterior, prolactin. Okay. We discussed hyperparathyroidism, primary, secondary, primary Mohn and Menn syndromes. Okay. Mohn's, Groen's, Thrones, Stone's, psychic Mohn's. Okay. Their evaluation with biochemically PTH calcium levels. And their surgery will be 3.5 subtotal parathyroidectomy most commonly. Then we did MTC discussion in which we discussed that presentation and evaluation will be like any other differentiated thyroid cancer or other thyroid nodules. And the treatment will, the evaluation will also depend on your calcitonin levels. The treatment will include surgery plus minus radiation, metastatic setting. You have options of surveillance, TKIs, and chemotherapy, dacarbazine. Then we discussed pancreas and NETs, all of them, gastrinoma, insulinoma, VIPoma, glaucoma together, body tail, and non-functioning ones. And we discussed adrenal tumors. Okay, 80% of them are adenomas. How to rule out an adenoma less than 10 HU, or if it is more than 10 HU, you see the contrast washout, absolute and relative. Okay, so we have discussed majority of the endocrine glands. So now in front of you is the same figure which we discussed later, and there are two of these diagrams that, you know, my senior taught me in MS days, not even in oncology actually. One of them is MEN1 and one of them is MEN2. So can you take a guess which one is what and what are these nodes here? Navneet, I think we'll stop and discuss this figure because this will all you will take away from this lecture today.
No, sir.
No? Okay. Kush, are you aware of this schematic diagram or representation?
Pituitary adenoma, parathyroid hyperplasia, and pheochromocytoma for first one.
No.
Not in center.
So what is in center? So these three center organs I've made, one is obviously pituitary. One is center, thyroid, hyperthyroid, both are in midline only, midline neck structure. So it can be one of the two. And which of the other organ that I have discussed are in the center?
Pancreas?
Yes, pancreas, correct. So this is your MEN1 essentially. Okay, a straight line with three midline organs. Your pituitary, your parathyroid, and your pancreas NETs. Okay, this is your MEN1 syndrome. Okay, so what is this now? This is MEN2 obviously, but what are these? 1, 2, and in the side.
One is MTC, then parathyroid, and pheochromocytoma.
Correct. So this is becomes your MEN1. This becomes your MEN2. MEN1 is three line. Your MEN2 is a triangle in which there is MTC and there is also hyperparathyroidism, both thyroid, parathyroid, and you have a lateral, bilateral pheochromocytoma. That's why it comes laterally. So if you can remember this one schematic diagram, like a mnemonic, I think it will help you out anytime you are thinking about Menn syndromes because it can be confusing. Okay. Are we very clear with this diagram now? You all will remember? Yeah.
Yes.
So before I put this table, I put that diagram because once you put this table, it becomes too much of information. Okay, so don't look at it. I will take you through it. So you have essentially four Menn syndromes. Okay, so now I'm going to start talking about Menn syndromes per se. You have four Menn syndromes, major types. MEN1, MEN2. MEN2 will also have MEN2A, MEN2B. MEN2B is also sometimes known as MEN3. And there is something called as MEN4. There are four syndromes. Okay? So MEN1, MEN2A, MEN2B, MEN4. Okay? Let's not read anything else and let's just know these four types. So as I discussed, MEN1 is these three and MEN2 is like this. So if you draw it on a single page, on a single schematic PA, you will remember it well. Pituitary, hyperparathyroid, pancreas, medullary thyroid, hyperparathyroid, and pheochromocytoma, MEN2. Okay. So what is generally MEN? MEN is multiple endocrine neoplasia. So it has to be multiple at least. It has to be more than one. So generally when you have two or more endocrine gland tumors, it's generally called as MEN syndrome. Okay. Why it is necessary to define this? Because this is the MEN clinical criteria. If you have an index case in your OPD in which you have two or more organs of endocrine system which are showing you tumors, it automatically becomes multiple endocrine neoplasia. Which one it will fall into comes later. But you need to first define what is MEN. MEN will be when you have two or more endocrine organs showing tumors. Okay? That is clear? Clinical criteria. So let's come to MEN1. Theoretically, the incidence is 0.25% at postmortem studies. Do we have Indian data? I could not find it. What is causing MEN1 syndrome? There's something called as a menin mutation, which is happening to the MEN1 gene at the 13q11 level. It's a Knudsen's two-hit hypothesis. So one allele will be disabled by the germline mutation, and a second allele, loss of heterozygosity, LOH, will happen, which will be the second hit, and this will lead to the tumor formation. So all the syndromes, generally the neurofibroma, BRCA, FAP, FAP, all these ones, they will talk about penetrance. Okay. So what is penetrance? Can someone just tell me? Kush or anyone. Can someone tell me what is penetrance?
Penetrance is the chance of the genotypic mutation converting into phenotype. Means if we have 50% chance, this means 50% penetrance means 50% chance of developing MEN syndrome.
Correct. So physical manifestation of a genetic abnormality. Perfect. So that is penetrance. So MEN1 has a high penetrance because you see by 40 years of age, 95% of the people will have some or the other physical manifestation of it. Okay, so that is a high penetration. If you remember your BRCA1 and BRCA mutation, what is the lifetime risk? By 45 to 55 years age, your chances are 60 to 70% of BRCA1 and 2, roughly in that range. So this penetration of this is more than BRCA. Okay, so it's a highly penetrant tumor. By 20 years itself, half of them will have some problem. Imagine, by 20 years, half of them will have some manifestation of MEN syndrome. And is it deadly? So in untreated patients of MEN, by 50 years of age, 50% of them will die if you don't treat any of them. This obviously comes by with older data. And what used to be the most common of death? Most common cause of death initially earlier used to be Zollinger-Edison syndrome, which is that gastrinoma. Why? Because earlier we didn't have PPIs. We didn't have somatostatin analog inhibitors. So some patients were undergoing surgery, others you didn't have anything to help them with. So the common cause of death used to be gastrinoma earlier. Now in this post-PPI era, okay, after osmeprazole and all the prazoles, the most common cause of death has changed. And now it is that non-functioning neuroendocrine tumor, the one which we don't give attention to, that is now the most common cause of death because it will metastasize and it will be the one which will give rise to serious consequences in the patient. Okay. So what are the different various forms of MEN syndrome? As I said, there is one clinical type. You have seen a patient in OPD in which MEN1 related tumors, you have seen two. So you have labeled it as clinical diagnosis, clinically MEN1 syndrome. Okay. You can also have a familial type, which is that patient will have a MEN1 associated tumor. And with that, he also has first degree related with a MEN1 tumor, but there is no gene abnormality. Okay, so that is the difference between familial and hereditary. Very common exam questions. Okay, so familial MEN1 will be like that. What will be a genetic MEN1? Which has a mutation. Okay, so who should be tested for it? If it's the index case, it's the first case, it should at least meet the clinical criteria. Okay, all the neuroendocrine tumors, you don't go testing for for MEN1. You don't go testing for primary hyperparathyroidism, all the patients for MEN1. No. If it's the first patient, it should have two or more MEN1 associated tumors. Or if it's the only tumor, there should be some suspicion. So what are those suspicions? That is important because now this is a relative area. Suspicions mean if it is a multi-gland parathyroid adenoma and it is before the age of 40. So meaning you have taken the multiplicity of the adenoma or hyperplasia and you have taken the age. So if both these are there, no other tumor is there. You have only parathyroid, but it is at a young age and it is multiglandular. Obviously, it is suspicious. Obviously, you will go ahead and test it. Similarly, multiple pancreatic NETs are there. So you have to go and see, or you have recurrent hyperparathyroidism. So these come under suspicious ones. Okay. Or you have single tumor only, but there's also first degree relative with a known MEN1 mutation. That is when you will do the testing. If you have already tested and there are other family members, first degree relatives, you have to do genetic counseling and you have to test them also. So when should you test them? How early as possible? So it is nothing like that. Even before 5 years of age, even if the patient is asymptomatic, you can go ahead and test them. Because as we will see later, some of these cancers can present as early as 5 years of age. Okay, so there's no age limit. You can test them at any age. So what are the individual tumors? As we saw, there were three main types. One was pituitary, one was parathyroid, one was pancreatic. Which is the most common? Parathyroid is the most common in MEN1. Which is the next most common? Pancreatic NET is the next most common. Next, which is most common? Pituitary adenoma. Of that, prolactinoma is the most common. Apart from these three, there are also other tumors which can be seen. You can have an adrenocortical tumor. Okay, you can have a pheochromocytoma. You can have a bronchopulmonary NET. You can have a thymic NET. You can have a gastric NET. So these other sites of endocrine glands can also have tumors. Okay, but these are the most common three types. So primary hyperparathyroidism in MEN1, it is the most common thing which you will see. It will be seen in 90%. It will have an earlier age at onset. So if you have a normal patient with primary hyperparathyroidism sporadic type, the mean age is 55 years. However, in MEN1 syndrome, it will be 20 to 25 years. It will be equally seen between males and females. The weird thing is, even though it is syndromic hyperparathyroidism, there will be no severe hypercalcemia. The hypercalcemia will be moderate or mild. And even though this is moderate or mild, they will have greater mineral density resection. So the changes in the bone will be of a greater extent. So what I understood by it was, because it is syndromic, the patient will be having hypercalcemia since a longer period of time, and it will be mild to moderate, and patient will have the other systems which have kicked in and reduced the calcium to certain level. But because this is a long standing hypercalcemia, the effects on the bone will definitely be greater. PTH carcinoma rare, I already told this. The time to treat in a MEN1 syndrome is controversial. And why it is controversial is, if you do a subtotal parathyroidectomy, persistent or recurrent hypercalcemia at 10 years is still 40 to 60%. And hypocalcemia, because you have removed orthoparathyroid, requiring long-term therapy is also 10 to 30%. So you remove everything, there's a 40% chance that it will be back. And there's a 30% chance that it will have a permanent hypocalcemia, which will require calcitriol and vitamin D and all those things. So that is why there is a controversy regarding when you should treat. So some guidelines are saying that if it's just one adenoma, it's a MEN1 syndrome, which is you have diagnosed it, and there's only one adenoma, rest of the glands, there's no uptake. So you do only one gland excision, leave the other glands. When it recurs, you remove. If it's multi-gland, obviously you have to go in and do a subtotal parathyroidectomy. If it is a symptomatic hypercalcemia, patient has one of those symptoms of Mohn's Groen's stones wala, then it is very easy to recommend surgery and go ahead and do a subtotal parathyroidectomy. It problem only happens when it's asymptomatic hypercalcemia. You've either detected it on screening or you have detected it after a new diagnosis of MEN1. Let's come to pancreatic NETs. Pancreatic NETs like parathyroid, they are will be found in little earlier age, around 30 to 40 years. They are multiple very frequently. Their behavior, you know, the sad part is uncertain. Sometimes you feel they are very small, they will not metastasize, but they metastasize. Sometimes you feel this is high grade and size is more, it will metastasize, but some studies have kept them on follow-up and they have not metastasized. So because there is no uniform single, you know, data which is coming from big studies, we don't know how they behave in MEN1. And that is why you have differing guidelines from different European and American, and different individual groups are also there, Uppsala group, etc., which have different guidelines. So let's go to them, the common ones one by one. Gastrinoma is most common. 50% of times in MEN1, it will be gastrinoma only. What will be the age? 30 to 35 years. 20%, in fact, of all gastrinomas will have MEN1 if you test them. Okay, so 1 out of 5 gastrinoma sporadic will turn out to be MEN1. What is unique is if you have gastrinoma as well as hyperparathyroidism, if you treat the hyperparathyroidism first with subtotal parathyroidectomy, in 20% of times, the Zollinger-Ellison syndrome gets resolved automatically. And why is this happening? Because, you know, we discussed in gastrinoma how to evaluate them. A calcium and secreting stimulation test also we discussed, correct? So a calcium is a secretory stimulus to gastrin in a normal human cell. So once you take out that hypercalcemia, 20% of times what's happening is the Zollinger-Ellison syndrome is getting resolved on its own and you don't have to even treat it medically. So that's a unique thing for MEN1 that you have to remember. I already told you for gastrinomas, you have to treat if it's pancreatic, that is head of pancreas gastrinoma, or if it is more than 2 cm in size. Duodenal gastrinomas are most commonly small. They are most commonly multiple. And surgery is not the first choice. You try to handle them medically. When you come to insulinoma, they are 10 to 30%. They are seen less than 40 years of age. First manifestation will be insulinoma in 10% of MEN1. That is unique. And the treatment of insulinoma is always surgery. Non-functioning NETs. Now, as I told, you are detecting it more because of improved screening modalities, and it is seen in up to 55% patients of MEN1. Then, when you compare them with functioning NETs, they obviously have a poorer prognosis because they will present late. And now they are the most common cause of death in MEN1, as I told repeatedly. The risk of METS also, I think I discussed, for more than 3 cm tumors, it's 43%, 18%, roughly 20% for 2 to 3 cm, and less than 1 cm is 4%. So what is recommended for non-functioning NET? You have to do surgery if the patient has symptoms, if it is more than 2 cm, or if the doubling time is less than 3 to 6 months. You have keeping the patient or follow up on repeated EUS, repeated imaging, and it was less than 2 cm, but within 3 months, 6 months, it is doubling in size, you go ahead for surgery. So I discussed parathyroid, I discussed pancreas. Now let's come to pituitary. Pituitary is seen in a very wide range, 10 to 50% depending on the series you look at. The average age is again, roughly 38 years. Generally, they are prolactinomas. Generally, they are macroadenomas. That is more than 1 cm in size. The treatment for them is generally dopamine agonist or surgery. The other tumors I told you can have bronchial thymic carcinoids. They are very aggressive tumors. They have to be treated surgically. Adrenocortical tumors, pheochromocytoma, surprisingly, is rare in MEN1. So you see pheochromocytoma, you think MEN2. Other adrenocortical tumors are more common in MEN1. Meningioma, lipomas, collagenomas, angiofibromas are other less common ones. So let's come to the screening recommendations for men one. So the most common one was parathyroid. What is the biochemical test? Serum calcium, serum PTH. When do you have to do it? You have to do it every year. When do you have to start doing it? You have to start doing it at 8 years. Do you have to do any imaging? No. You do only biochemical, and according to biochemical, you do imaging. For the pancreatic ones, see, you have to do a gastrin test. You have to do a fasting glucose insulin. You have to do chromogranin, pancreatic polypeptide, and glucagon VIP. You have to do this whole thing annually. And when do you start? You start at these ages, 10 to 20 years. Okay. And you have to do for non-functioning NETs, you have to do an annual imaging also, which can be either MRI, CT, or EUS. EUS has the best sensitivity. When it comes to anti-pituitary, you do prolactin and IGF levels, and you do an MRI every 3 years. For adrenals, you don't do any biochemical unless the patient has symptoms. You only do an MRI or CT, which is annual, which you do with the pancreatic. Anyway, you'll be doing it for the pancreatic one. You have to see the adrenal glands also. The thymic and bronchial carotenoid, it says that you have to do the image of the chest once every 2 years at least. Okay, so men one clear. Any doubts? Should I go to men two?
Yes, yes.
Okay, bored already? Should I stop? Okay, we'll complete men 2 and men 3, men 4. Don't worry. It's the men 1 is the big part of the thing. Men 2 and men 3, men 4 are actually not that detailed. So men 2 is, see, when you hear men 2, you have to think about MTC because that's the most common thing. You have to think of medullary thyroid cancer with a RET mutation. Okay, so all the men 2 tumors will have a RET mutation. Men 1 was menin-tube mutation. Okay. MEN2 is RET mutation, and it will happen in all the tumors of MEN2. RET mutation generally happens in neural crest cell origin tumors. So all these tumors, which are medullary thyroid, pheochromocytoma, they all come from neural crest cells. MEN2A is when there is medullary thyroid cancer with pheochromocytoma. This will be seen in 20 to 50% of times, or it can be medullary thyroid cancer with primary hyperparathyroidism. That can be seen up to 20% of times. MEN2B is when you have MTC plus PHEO and you also have a marfanoid habitus, you have mucosal neuromas. Okay, so that's what makes it MEN2B, marfanoid and mucosal neuromas. That makes it MEN2B, that is MEN3, as we had discussed earlier. So MEN2A is MEN2, MEN2B is MEN3. Apart from that, there's also something called as familial MTC, where you have only MTC and no PHEO and no primary hyperparathyroidism. So MTC, we have discussed more or less of it. Up to 100% of men 2 will have MTC. When you have in men 2A, you will have it around 30 years of age. In men 2B, it is seen in earlier ages. RET testing has to be done in all the patients of medullary thyroid cancer, irrespective of family history, irrespective of their age or whatever. Once you have a medullary thyroid cancer patient, now it is recommended that you do RET testing in all of them. If positive, you have to do a plasma metanephrine level also to rule out pheochromocytoma. If it is positive, you go ahead and do imaging. If you have pheochromocytoma as well as medullary thyroid, you do the pheochromocytoma first. Because if you do the medullary first, your BP may shoot up. Even if it is normal now, after giving the incision, it may shoot up. Pheochromocytomas in men 2 generally are bilateral up to 72% of times. If you remember, there's a 10% mnemonic for pheochromocytomas. 10% times you will have raised catecholamines. 10% of times they'll be bilateral. 10% of times they'll be extra-adrenal. 10% of times they'll be with inherited syndromes like men, neurofibroma, and which one? Third one, I'm forgetting. Okay, so in men, it will be bilateral 70% of time. So what is the screening for men too? Generally, it depends on the risk of the codon. So when you do a threat mutation testing, they will give you the codon at which the mutation is present. And they will also tell you which kind of codon is there. So there are few codons which are highest risk. There are few which are high risk. There are few that are moderate risk. If it is the highest risk type, you don't do any thyroid screening. Okay. You do a thyroidectomy as soon as possible, even if the patient is in the first year of his life. You start pheochromocytoma screening at 11 years. Okay. And because you have done a thyroidectomy very early, there's no role of primary hyperthyroid screening also. If it is a high risk type, the general surgery is 3 to 5 years. You have to do a thyroid screening and thyroidectomy younger than 5 years. And if it's a moderate risk, generally you can wait till young adulthood. How that young adulthood is defined is generally, I think, in the teenage years. The pheochromocytoma screening is generally for the high risk at 11 years and for the moderate risk at 16 years. This brings us to MEN4. So MEN3 was meant to be. What is MEN4? MEN4 is nothing but MEN1. You have the phenotype of MEN1. That is, you have all those tumors, pituitary, parathyroid, pancreas, and those other adrenocortical, bronchial, thymic carcinoids. You have all those tumors, but the mutation is not MEN1. The mutation is not menin, but the mutation is this cyclin dependent kinase CDK inhibitor 1B, CDKN1B. This is the mutation that you are finding germline. So because this is a different type of mutation than the MEN1, they cannot put these patients in MEN1, so they put them in MEN4. This is still a newer kind of syndrome. There is not a lot of data on it, and no standard criteria have been developed till now. Okay. So with that, I will finish the MEN syndrome talk. I would suggest that you read, obviously, the Devita chapter on MEN. There are these two very nice papers, Clinical Practice Guidelines by Rajesh Thakkar et al., written in 2012, and by Stratakis et al., an update on this paper in 2019. With that, obviously, you will read the ATA guidelines for medullary thyroid cancer. Okay. So that's all from my side.
Thank you, Rajan.
Yeah. So those of you who don't know, I also coordinate the ISO Academics Masterclass series. That is every fortnight we do this case presentation followed by an expert talk by one of the examiners. The next one is stomach cancer and it is on 18th of Feb. Okay, so those of you interested can join in. It's not just for surgical PGs, others can also help. Okay, I think there's something very exhaustive. Thank you, Redmi. Whoever you have seen, how many cases of MEN syndrome have you seen? Okay, so good question. So with that, I would tell you the last MEN syndrome patient when I have seen 1 week back, and we operated on that patient also. So this was a gentleman who was a 45-year-old gentleman who on corona screening got his whole body scan, and he came to know that he has a distal pancreatic tumor, he has a lung tumor, and he has a parathyroid lesion. Okay, so I'm giving you the case scenario now. He has no symptoms. He's absolutely fine. He went to get COVID test done and got all these scans done. He has a parathyroid lesion, he has a lung lesion, and he has a distal pancreatic lesion. Now, can you tell me how we evaluated? Now, we've discussed all this. So I'll request Redmi to unmute, because let's discuss with them, whoever is Redmi. Can you unmute? Okay, take it. Kush or Namneet, can you tell me? Based on our discussion.
Look like a clinical MEN syndrome with the features suggestive of MEN1.
So correct. Very good. So it has clinical criteria met of a MEN tumor. Okay, but you cannot call it a MEN tumor now, because see, just because I'm imaging, you have found a lesion in the parathyroid, yeah. The distal pancreatic lesion, you don't know what it is. So you do a biochemical evaluation.
Yes. Okay. Yes.
So, yeah, correct. So in this gentleman, the distal pancreatic tumor, the biochemical evaluation was normal and an FNAC from the tumor was NET grade 1. We did a system EB scan for this gentleman, and there was a multiglandular parathyroid lesion. Okay. One adenoma and all other glands also picking up. So parathyroid hyperplasia with an adenoma. Now, what about the lung? Does it fall into men 1?
It can be metastasis also.
It can be bronchial NET or lung NET.
Correct. So it can be all that. So what we did was we did a biopsy from it, and to our surprise, it was adenocarcinoma lung. We did an IHC and everything. It was TTF1 positive. So he does qualify for Menone syndrome, but this was lung adenocarcinoma, which is not a part of Menone syndrome. It was an incidentally diagnosed Menone syndrome and an incidentally diagnosed lung cancer. So now we discussed all this. It was NET grade 1, parathyroid adenoma asymptomatic, and lung adenocarcinoma. So any idea how we treated it? What would be your preference?
Hello?
Yeah.
What did you operate, Sajan bhai?
Bhai, I am asking you. Please tell me what we should operate. So we discussed in our tumor board, and hello, what they said, what makes sense is, the patient has the highest risk to his life with the adenocarcinoma lung. So we staged the patient for lung adenocarcinoma. It came out to be early, but a NET grade 1 tumor will not be as life-threatening as a lung adenocarcinoma will be. So at present, we have treated him for lung cancer, and as he will complete his chemotherapy, then we will take him up for the neuroendocrine part. It was a large distal pancreatic tumor. We'll have to go in for that surgery also. Apart from that, we see quite routinely pheochromocytoma with medullary thyroid cancer patients. We have done quite a few patients on bilateral pheochromocytoma also. My boss, Dr. T.S. Rao, Dr. Rakesh Sharma, both of them with me, we have done few cases. In that, we had 3-4 patients last year only of medullary thyroid cancer with pheochromocytoma. We chose to do pheochromocytoma first and then MTC in the second setting. I hope that answers your question. Okay, sir, what about this patient's parathyroid? So this parathyroid adenoma patient clinically has no hypercalcemia, no hyperparathyroidism. Both levels are normal. So for that, we are going to keep that patient on follow-up. Our second preference is going to be the neuroendocrine tumor, and we'll just keep the parathyroid on surveillance.
If we, like, incidentally on a routine scan somewhere we detect a mass in the pancreas, like about say 1 or 2 centimeters, so should we go for like all the screening for the Menone syndromes in all the cases?
Not at all, Namit. If you have a pancreatic lesion, you have to treat it like a pancreatic lesion only. What are the most common pancreatic lesions? You have to start with benign, then don't jump to malignancy first. There are so many benign pancreatic conditions. Is it a pseudocyst? Is it a cystic neoplasm of the pancreas? It's a pancreatic adenocarcinoma. There are so many things. You have to see the imaging, you have to see the US, get a gastroenterologist opinion. Don't jump to Menone. Menone syndrome is very, very uncommon.
Right.
I see my colleague Dr. Madhu is also there. Hi, Madhu.
Sajan bhai, one question.
Hello. Yeah.
In the same case, you said that the pancreatic mass was larger, right?
Correct.
So you said that in case of man 1, the most common chance of death, if untreated, is because of mets from non-functional NET. So, meanwhile, you treat lung adenocarcinoma. Obviously, you will be surveying the patient. But can you do anything for the this non-functioning pancreatic NET? I mean, anything like PRRT or somatostatin analogs? I know it's non-functioning, but so can you do anything, or it's okay to survey it?
No. So it's not surveillance. The thing is, for lung cancer, the surgery becomes a major surgery. Okay. And you will be giving patient adjuvant chemotherapy also based on the staging. in an ideal case scenario, it would have been okay to operate both together, but then it becomes a very, very major procedure. We have to do the lung surgery also, which itself becomes a quite a major surgery. We didn't want to combine the two. I'm sure there must be centers where they could have done both together, but we chose to do only one. Give chemo also, anyway, that gives you time to test the biology of that tumor. And yeah.
So that I got it. But do you need to do anything for...
We need to treat it. We need to operate it. That's all. We need to evaluate it, do the imaging. Yeah, and because the biochemical, this patient has no symptoms of any hormone excess. Biochemically, all the hormones were normal. So it's very less likely that, you know, all these treatments will help him.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, Namit, can we...
It was really wonderful, sir, interacting with and learned many new things. So it was really like something I was not knowing, men syndromes, and you explained all through different endocrine glands, all their functions there individually, and then you how beautifully you correlated all the men syndromes together. It was a very nice lecture, sir. Really learned a lot from it, and we look forward to more learning from you, sir. So thank you so much.
My advice only would be, when you think of men syndrome, think laterally. Just go back to all the endocrine glands. Just remember the discussion that we had. Remember that schematic diagram, and I think you guys will be fine.
Yes, sir. Wonderful, wonderful.
Okay, that's for basic where we are. Obviously, we have to learn more, keep reading more, and learn from our seniors also. Okay.
Yes. Thank you. Yeah. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Bye, guys. Bye, everyone.
Bye. Thank you.